This is a short tutorial on how to identify the intermolecular force, the predominant intermolecular force in a molecule. So just as a refresher, there are three types of intermolecular forces. If the molecule overall is nonpolar, then its only intermolecular force is the London dispersion force, which as you will remember is the weakest intermolecular force. If the molecule overall is polar, and has no possibility of hydrogen bonding. In other words, it does not contain a hydrogen bonded directly to either a fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen, then it has its predominant intermolecular force is the dipole-dipole attraction. If the molecule is polar and it can hydrogen bond, that is, it contains hydrogens directly bonded to either fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen, then its predominant intermolecular force is hydrogen bonding. So let's look at some examples that kind of help you. There is one worksheet with answer key posted already on identifying intermolecular force that's kind of basic, and I'm going to post the ones I'm going to be working examples from right now just for a little bit more depth. All right, so how do we go about identifying the type of intermolecular force? The first thing you want to do always is draw the Lewis structure. Don't try to get out of doing that or you will make mistakes. Why do we do that? You need to draw the Lewis structure in order to determine the shape of the molecule, and it is the three-dimensional shape of the molecule that determines whether it's symmetric or not. Once you've drawn the shape and determined the symmetry, you will be able to know if it's a polar or nonpolar molecule. So let's do a couple of examples. If you watched my other short little video on drawing molecular shapes and Lewis structures, one of the examples I did there was sulfur dioxide, and the Lewis structure of sulfur dioxide looks like this. And once we have that drawn, you can see that it is not a symmetric shape. If you look on your molecular shape chart in your textbook, in this molecule, sulfur has three electron domains, which gives it a trigonal planar electron domain shape. And just looking at the atoms without paying attention to the non-bonding pairs, that molecular shape is bent. So it is not a symmetrical molecule. Therefore, it is polar. And since it's polar with no possibility of hydrogen bonding, its main intermolecular force is dipole-dipole. Water, which should be easy for all of you now, has a Lewis structure that looks like this. Its molecular shape is also bent. Anytime you have a bent structure, it is not symmetrical. Even though it looks the same, if you were to draw a plane up and down, if you drew a plane across the middle, it doesn't look the same top and bottom. So it has to be symmetric from all angles and planes in order to be considered totally symmetric. So anyway, water is not symmetric, so it's polar. And it also contains the possibility for hydrogen bonding. In other words, it has an oxygen directly bonded to a hydrogen. So the main intermolecular force for water is hydrogen bonding. The next one, the molecule or the formula is CH2Cl2. That's kind of like, it's similar to methane, CH4. Now methane would be nonpolar, it's all carbon hydrogen, but it's also, methane would also be symmetric. If we draw out the tetrahedral shape of CH2Cl2, it's actually not symmetric. So you could draw dipoles, and when you draw a dipole, the arrow always points to the more electronegative atom. You can see the dipoles you have for highly electronegative chlorine, that this overall molecule has a net, and there are my dogs, has a net polarity or dipole in one particular direction. So it is a polar molecule. It cannot hydrogen bond because although it does have hydrogen atoms, they are not directly bonded to either fluorine, oxygen, or nitrogen. So the main intermolecular force in this molecule is dipole-dipole. The next one is very interesting. You should be able to draw the Lewis structure and the shape for this. The formula given is just SCO, SCO, and kind of looks like carbon dioxide, which I'll talk about in a minute. But the shape of this is linear. Now, linear, if the outside atoms were identical, would be symmetric. But in this case, you have two different atoms on the ends, an oxygen and a sulfur. So it is not symmetric. Therefore, it is polar. There are no hydrogens. So the main intermolecular force is dipole-dipole. I drew carbon dioxide down at the bottom because it's such similar structure to the SCO. In this case, though, because you have oxygens on both ends, the structure is symmetric, and therefore carbon dioxide is nonpolar. So carbon dioxide, even though it has polar bonds, both of these carbon-oxygen bonds are polar. They oppose each other. They cancel out. So there is no net polarity to carbon dioxide, and it only has London dispersion forces. All right, a couple more. Phosphorus trichloride. If you draw the Lewis structure, you discover there is a non-bonding pair of electrons on the phosphorus. And let's see, the electron domain shape would be tetrahedral, but the molecular shape, that's when you ignore the non-bonding pair, and would have a trigonal pyramidal shape. It is not symmetric, okay? Mainly if you think about putting a mirror here, the top and bottom are not identical. It's not symmetric, therefore it is polar, and dipole-dipole are the main intermolecular force. The last one I wanted to do is sulfur trioxide. Sulfur is one of the elements that very regularly expands its octet to hold more than 8 valence electrons. You can see in this structure 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 valence electrons around the sulfur, which is fine. And so the shape of this is trigonal planar. Okay, that means all of these bonds are in the same plane. And so although you have 3 polar bonds, they all cancel out, and so there's no net dipole, no net polarity in sulfur trioxide. It is symmetric, it's nonpolar, and therefore the only intermolecular force it can have is London dispersion. That is it for identifying intermolecular forces.